All right, let's get started. It's my pleasure to introduce Stefano Martignoni. Stefano is a professor at NYU, and as you can see from his affiliations, his research interest is extremely broad. Do you have any plan to have a joint appointment with the biology department?
No, too many emails.
So Stefano actually interviewed here for the media fellowship three or four years ago. So some of you might remember him. Today he's gonna tell us about the other side of entropy. Dark side or light side?
Dark side, yeah. Okay. All right, thank you, Inzao. All right, yeah, so I recently moved to NYU January of this year. Prior to that, I was an assistant professor at the University of Minnesota for 2 years, but the Simons Foundation has made a generous donation to NYU to create this new Simons Center for Computational Physical Chemistry, and I was jointly hired by the physics department and the chemistry department. I have an associated appointment with Courant, which is the math department at NYU. So it was quite difficult to decide what to present today because as Yunsao mentioned, I do a lot of things and I feel like everyone is interested in everything here. So I really wanted to please everybody, but in the end, I'm only going to please Yunsao and talk about, I'm going to stay true to my abstract, but I'm going to take a little detour to cover the sort of thing that Yunsao is interested in right now. So my interest in entropy started with non-equilibrium statistical physics, particularly granular physics. And you can trace back the origin of the field of granular physics to a paper written in 1989 by legendary theoretical physicist Sam Edwards, that with his student Oakeshott proposed that you should be able to develop a statistical mechanical description of grains. So the idea here was that, so he says, you know, we can read directly what he says in his abstract. He says, starting from the observation that powders have a large number of particles and reproducible properties, we show how statistical mechanics applies to powders. The volume of the powder plays the role of the energy in conventional statistical mechanics, with the hypothesis that all the states of a specified volume are equally probable. So what he's doing is that he's making the Gibbsian assumption that all the microstates of the system are equally probable. And then he went on and he said, well, if you are going to develop a statistical mechanical theory, you're gonna have to introduce an entropy. And so he said, we will argue that powders have an entropy, but it will be the volume which plays the role of energy in normal statistical mechanics. And so the entropy, as it was defined by him, was S equal KB log of omega, where omega here is the number of mechanically stable structures in a jam packing. So the idea here was that the physics of grains is controlled by the stable states of the packings. And what we set ourselves up for was to try and demonstrate that these assumptions are reasonable, that indeed you can define a meaningful entropy for a non-equilibrium system made of grains, and that for certain protocols, the volumes of the states are indeed equally probable. So the questions that we want to answer are easy to pose, but they're difficult to answer, just like all good questions. And so what we have is that we have m particles, okay, in some volume V, and these particles interact through an energy function, okay? They could be repulsive. What we wanna know is what is the total number of possible stable packings? In other words, how many minima are there in the energy landscape defined by the interaction between the particles? And the second question is, can we compute the probabilities of these individual states, which amounts to saying, can we compute the volume of the basin of attraction of these individual minima? So while the type of problems that I'll be discussing are within the realm of granular physics, these methodologies and these ideas extend generally to dynamical systems theory and all systems whose properties are controlled by some fixed points that have an associated basin of attraction. So let's set up the problem. what we have is that we have, so we're gonna work with packings. And so how do we make these packings? So what we do is that we start with an equilibrium configuration of hard disks, okay? So imagine placing down disks randomly. And this system is in a state where it's a liquid, right? So it's gonna flow, all right? So what we do is that we inflate these hard disk configurations. So now we take the nominal volume fraction of the system above a critical density, at which if we relax the system, we're always gonna end up in a mechanically stable state. This point is called the jamming point. And so if now we relax the system, you'll see that we're going to set into a minimum energy configuration that is gonna be a mechanically stable structure, okay? So from the point of view of the phase space, so the space of configurations, when I showed you the hard disk liquid, what we had is that we had a configurational space in which some points were accessible. So the configuration that I showed you would have been one point in this space. And then there are non-accessible regions, which are this gray shaded area that coincide to overlaps, okay? So white is the region that satisfies the constraint of non-overlaps, and gray is the non-accessible region because it does not satisfy the constraint. Now, when I inflated the particles, what I did is that I generated an underlying energy surface that now has minima and partitioned space in basins of attraction, okay? So now there's gonna be a set of minima, which are my states of interest. These are the jam packings. And to each of these jam packings, there's gonna be an associated basin of attraction. And the collection of all the basin of attraction is going to tile my configurational space. And this is going to be crucial to enumerate the number of minima, which is what we wanna do. So now to illustrate how we're going to tackle this intractable enumeration problem, because there is an extremely large number of these minima, I'm going to use an analogy. Now imagine you were flying above Manhattan, New York City, that's where I live, and let's say that you wanted to enumerate how many buildings there are in Manhattan. Now you can, if you're patient, you can count them all, okay? But I'm not. And so you can try to be smart about it and sample, okay? So what you could do is that you can basically pinpoint buildings at random, right? And so you could pick that one, and then that one, and then that one, and then that one. And you keep doing this for a while until you can construct a histogram, okay? So now you're gonna have some distribution of areas that you've measured by picking individual buildings. Some will be large, some will be small. But this distribution is biased because the probability of picking a large building is higher than the probability of picking a small building, right? Imagine dropping a pencil on a map, right? The probability will be directly proportional to the area. Mm-hmm. And so what you can do is that you can unbias this distribution. And now given the unbiased distribution, you can estimate the true mean area of buildings in Manhattan. So if I now wanna enumerate how many buildings there are, what I'm gonna do is that I'm gonna say that the total area of the island is equal to the sum of the areas of the individual buildings, okay? And so by definition of arithmetic mean, if I wanna know omega, I just have to divide the total area by the average area of the buildings. And so now if I can estimate this number, I can enumerate the number of buildings, or in the case of the energy landscape, I can enumerate the number of minima in the landscape, okay? So the challenge here is going to be to measure these areas, which are not gonna be areas, they're gonna be volumes in high dimensions. So let's talk about basins of attraction. What is a basin of attraction? Well, the basin is this, so if you have a one-dimensional system here, which is just points along this line with an associated energy U of X, a basin of attraction is going to be the set of all points from where, if I relax the system, I end up in a specific minimum. So if I relax my system from there, following the steepest descent dynamics, I'm going to end up at this point. And the basin is going to be the collection of all the points from where, if I follow the dynamics of steepest descent, I'm going to end up at the same point. Now, in 1D, it's very simple. In 2D, it's a little bit more complicated. So I can take this made up mixture of Gaussian surface, and I can draw random points within the circle, and I can follow trajectories of steepest descent and steepest ascent to trace my basins. So if I do that, this is how the space becomes partitioned, and you can say you can see that the structure of the Bayesian starts becoming a little bit less trivial than it was in the one-dimensional case. But we're going to work with systems of particles, hundreds, thousands of particles, means that our space is going to be in thousands of dimensions. And so how can we think about high-dimensional space? And so now I'm going to take a little bit of an aside, just so that I can give a little bit of intuition about high-dimensional geometry. So I cannot show you something like what I showed you in the previous slide, because we cannot visualize high-dimensional space. But what we can do is that we can take a slice of it. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to take some high-dimensional cube, and I'm going to slice it, okay? And so, and what we're going to be looking at will be a section of the Bayesian of attractions that are sitting on this slide. So in practical terms, imagine taking a 3D landscape that is tiled by cubic basins. So now each little, so this is like a Rubik's cube, okay? But imagine it's made of little cubes throughout, not just on the surface. And the what we have is that the each color, so each little cube here, is a different basin. Okay, so now I have cubic basins that are tiling in a regular grid the space. What I can do is that I can take some cut of it, okay? And what I'll be looking at is what my system, you know, at a two-dimensional slice of it, like here, and so I will be looking like which basins do I see in this two-dimensional slice of a high-dimensional object. So this is just a 2D cut of a 3D object, so this is just some Kagome-like arrangement. But in high dimensions, what I can do if I want to, you know, learn something interesting is that I can choose a specific projection, okay? So what I'm going to do here is, so here we have these high-dimensional tilings of cubes, okay? Each cube has a different color. And I can choose a 2D plane that yields for a specific cube a 2D gon, okay? That is the most number of sides that you can have on a two-dimensional object cut out of a D-dimensional object, okay? There is a specific recipe to generate this. And it's generated through a set of Moray pattern of parallel lines. You can see this very well in 4D. You can see that you have all these parallel lines and you have D of them. And together they give you the octagon here because you're in four dimensions. And then you can see what the space looks around it. So now if I go to 16 dimensions, it looks like this. You can see that along this section, my cube is becoming almost spherical. And by the time you get to 32 dimensions, it's essentially a circle because you have 64 sides, okay? And the environment has this interesting structure where the density of the basin is really, really, really high around it. So there is some section in which my high dimensional cube is basically a circle, okay? If I'm in very high dimensions. If I take the same plane and I bring it to a corner of the cube, this is what it looks like. And so what you can see here is that in 16 dimensions, at the corner of my cube, there are 32 neighbors. So there are 32 of the spikes that come to the corner of the cube, okay? And so this is a way of visualizing the fact that these high dimensional objects are spiky in high dimensions. You can see it directly in this projection. Now, the next thing I want to show you about high dimensional space is that these cubes have no interior volume, meaning that if I were to draw a sphere inside it, you would have no volume compared to the volume in the corners. Okay? So what I'll do is that I'll carve out the largest inscribed hypersphere inside the cube, okay, which is a ball. And then I'm going to divide I'm going to say that the ball is one basin, and so it's one tile, and the remainder of the cube is another tile. And I can take a random slice of this big tiling, okay, like I did before. So if you do it in 3D, you recover again this Kagome-like lattice, and you can see the circles inside each of the cubes, so that makes sense. I can do this in 4D, again, I see the circles. 6D, the circles are going away. 8D, fewer, 16D, no circles. So if you take a high dimensional tiling of cubes, draw the largest inscribed sphere inside the cube, and you cut it, you're never gonna go through a sphere. because there is no volume associated with the sphere. And even though I knew this mathematically, I find this to be a very, you know, crazy way of illustrating it, that you can take one of these dimensional objects, take a random slice of it, and you'll never go through a sphere. So our high-dimensional basins, or in this particular case, cubes, look a lot like this. They're sea urchins, where there is no volume associated with the core. So this is, the color here is literally the density, okay? The true density of the cube that we've computed, okay? And all the volume is concentrated into the spikes, okay? Which are the corners of the cube. Now, if I wanted to estimate the volume of this object, I could try by brute force Monte Carlo. So I could basically take the largest circumscribed sphere and pick random points inside this gigantic ball, okay? And what you would see, if you were looking at the fraction of volume within a certain radius, okay, for different dimensions, you would see that when you are in low dimensions, you can basically sample points all the way to the end, okay? But if the number of dimensions increase, at some point, you will no longer be able to pick points inside the spikes, because the relative amount of volume in the spike and in the ball is basically going to zero. And so if you try to do this in 64 dimensions or 32 dimensions, you already are completely out of luck, and all of the volume will be concentrated out here. So if you were to try to estimate the volume of this object, you will be far off, because you wouldn't pick any points in the regions that actually matter. So how do you solve this problem? Well, we take one out of the statistical mechanics book. So the problem of integrating volumes in another dimension is something that chemists and statistical physicists deal with all the time, because they measure free energy for molecular systems that are extremely high dimensional, and the free energy is just a volume. So what we can do is that we take these objects and we perform a series of random walks where we couple our walker with a spring constant to a point of interest, which in our case will be the minimum. So when the spring constant is very, very strong, we will be constrained to a region that is hyperspherical, and they will be entirely contained inside the basin. When the spring constant has an intermediate value, we will be constrained, but now we will start exploring regions that are farther away from the core. And by the time our spring constant is zero, we will basically go into one of these corners and will never come back, because that's where all of the volume is. So to alleviate this issue that you never come back from one of these trips into the corners, what we do is that we do replica exchange Monte Carlo, where we basically define different Hamiltonians for different walkers, and we swap the Hamiltonians so that you can basically make your way back to the center and then depart and go into another direction. Now, the output of this series of random walks, biased random walks, is a series of histograms, where here what I'm showing is the probability of being at a certain distance r with a given value of the spring constant, okay? And what you see is that you have this series of histograms, which now I want to reweight, okay? And by reweighting them, I can compute the volume. And in the top of the volume, I can also get the density of states. And so what the density of states looks like as a function of dimensionality is what I was saying earlier, that the volume, as you increase dimensions, moves further and further away from the core, okay? So h here is basically how much of the volume of the cube is at a given distance r. So now you say, well, okay, that's 10. What does that mean, right? How bad it is? It's this bad. That if I compute, I can do this analytically, the probability of ball picking and being inside the sphere, meaning you can draw a sphere of radius r, you pick a random point on the sphere, and you ask, what is the probability that I'm inside the cube? The point where all of the probability mass is for a cube in 1,000 dimensions is a place where the probability of ball picking is 10 to the minus 76. So there is just no way that you can compute the volume of a cube by brute force Monte Carlo. You need to do important sampling. And so this is, in practice, if I constrain the total number of samples that I'm going to generate, and I compare brute force to our approach, mBAR is just a free energy calculation method, what you can see is that we can estimate the volume all the way to 1,000 dimensions for a fixed amount of samples, while the Monte Carlo fails as soon as the fraction of the volume of the cube to that of the circumscribed ball approaches 1 over the number of samples. Another way of looking at this is that if we decided to do Monte Carlo with 10 to the 80 samples, so we were to draw points 10 to the 80 times, we would only be able to measure volumes in 260 dimensions. And I'm pretty sure you cannot get 10 to the 80 samples. Okay, enough of cubes. Now let's get to the real stuff, which are the bases of attraction in this high dimensional landscape. So now in the cube, it's trivial to know when you're inside the cube and outside the cube, right? But for a basin of attraction, I don't know anything, right? I only know where the minimum is. And so what I need is a function that I call the oracle. And the oracle tells me when I'm inside and when I'm outside, okay? And the only way you can construct an oracle in general for an energy landscape is by solving for the path of steepest descent at every step in your Monte Carlo. So this is an incredibly expensive calculation because at every step, you have to do a full energy minimization. And so if you're inside, you will go back to the minimum of interest. If you're outside, you will just go somewhere else. And so the way people in this field usually deal with minimization problems is by using convex optimization methods, things like LBFGS or FIRE or Nesterov gradient, accelerated gradient methods, right? But do they preserve the geometry of the landscape? And so we generated these random cuts for a system of 16 soft disks, which is a 32 dimensional space. And you can see that if you use FIRE, which is a commonly used optimization algorithm, you get a slice that looks something like this. And I mean, you probably have no expectation as to what it should look like, but it doesn't look particularly smooth, right? You would expect that if the underlying energy function is smooth, the separation of the basin should be somewhat smooth, right? But often when you look at nonlinear systems and you try to make these maps, they always look like a mess. And often it's because of the minimization algorithm that you're using that is unstable with respect to the actual, well, the issue is that it's not actually following the path of steepest descent.
Is it a mess because you're high dimensional, or is it a mess because
it's a mess because the minimizer is not actually solving the differential equation defining the path of steepest descent. It's just looking for a minimum. So optimization algorithms are designed to find a minimum. They're not designed to find the minimum corresponding to the path of steepest descent. And so that was the observation that my student Prahar Shuladevara made at the beginning of his PhD. He said, but why do we use optimizer? We don't want to optimize. We want to solve ODEs, right? And so what we did is that we picked an ODE solver that can, a fairly sophisticated one, that can deal with stiffness, variance in gradients. It's implicit, adaptive, multi-step. You just add all the properties of ODE solver that you like, and this is what you get. And you can see that the true slice is smooth, okay? Now, there's a couple of interesting observations that you can things that you can learn from a slide like this. One is that basins are most certainly not convex because this basin here is in three pieces. So high dimensional basins of attraction in energy landscapes, at least for this class of systems, are definitely not convex. The other thing that is really cool is that you get these points here from where they look like points that generate basins. Okay, from this point, you have many, many, many basins coming out of it. And I think that those coincide with some high dimensional saddle points from where you're essentially unstable. And if you try to sit on it, you will always, if you displace minimally from it, you will end up into one of the neighbors. Now, as you increase dimensionality, things get much worse than this. So now if I take an ODE solver with a very, very small tolerance, I keep lowering my tolerance until the slice doesn't change anymore. And you compare it to what you get by a method like FIRE or LBFGS, by the time you get to 100 particles, you get 100% error, which means that you no longer find the true minima. You will find something else, and these cuts look like confetti, like they are completely scattered at that point. So now, just for fun, I'm gonna show you, this is a video that we made for a science art gallery. For the APS, so you can find it on YouTube. So what we did is that we took one of these two-dimensional slices and then we picked an orthogonal direction and we pushed in that orthogonal direction and we asked, what does it look like when I move through the landscape? And this is what it looks like. If you watch it on YouTube, there is electronic music that goes along with it. So it's quite cool. So it looks like that. And there are some cool features. So those points that generate basin that I was talking about, they appear to be conserved and they move around until they come together and then they generate two more points. So they look like there's some kind of topological charge in these lights. But these are, oh, by the way, a lot of the stuff I'll be telling you today is unpublished and preliminary because I get bored about talking about published work. So we're still looking into this, but there is definitely things that we can learn from it. But you can see sometimes you see like superstructures, like ellipses that then are within divided into multiple basins. So there's definitely things to be learned from here, besides the fact that it's beautiful.
So these are these particles, right, that settle? What's the scale, like how many particles do we see?
So these are, this is a slice in high dimensions, right? So it's a 2D slice cut in high dimensions. So what you do is that you pick two random vectors in high dimensions and you construct a plane, okay? And so then what you do is that you construct this plane, you discretize into pixels, and from every pixel coincide to an initial condition, right? And then you minimize from there.
Yeah.
And so you want to know what is the difference between two pixels in terms of particle positions?
So I want to understand when you write there were these big ellipses that grew and shrank. Like,
yeah.
I think of them as that's like a single particle that does something.
Or... No. These are all collective motions of the system, because these are taken from random positions. So when I'm moving. I'm moving in a direction of a random vector in configuration space. In the configuration space, each dimension is a coordinate of a particle. And so if I have n particles, this is 2D, I have 2n coordinates. So this is a two-dimensional slice in a 2n dimensional space. And so this is 16 particles, so it's 32 dimensions. And because the direction is random, everything will be moving. If I pick a given pixel and I push, it will be, everything will move. It will not be a single particle, as far as the initial condition goes. Okay, so, all right. So now that I've given you an intuition about high dimensional space, probably didn't get anything away from it other than the fact that it's a mess. Now we can get back to the issue of enumerating states, because we want to compute entropies. And so, remember, I said the landscape is tiled by basins of attraction. And what we want to do is that we want to measure the average volume of these basins. And I showed you that we can measure volumes in high dimensions. And then we're going to divide the total accessible volume by the average volume of the basins. And the first thing that we expect is that the number of basins will grow extensively the entropy will. And that's indeed what we see. So these were calculations done by Asenjo prior to my PhD. These were calculations that I did during my PhD. And you can see that the entropy grows linearly with the system size as a meaningful entropy should. The other thing that we learned, and this was a test of the so-called Edwards conjecture. So the conjecture was that all the states are equally probable at some point. What we found is that if we compute the Boltzmann entropy, which is log of omega, and the Gibbs entropy, which is sum of P log P, which is the same as the Shannon entropy, as I'll be telling you in a bit. These two quantities are the same only when the probability of seeing a state is 1 over omega, meaning that all of the probabilities are the same. And what we observed is that as we lowered the density in our system, so as we made our particles smaller and smaller, yet we were above the critical point, these two quantities tend together, they come close together. And if you extrapolate, you find that the extrapolation point is precisely the critical point. And so this is the simplest way of looking at this. There were other type of analysis that we did and we found always the same point. And so what this is showing is that at this special point, which is a jamming point, it appears that the probability that the basins of attraction all have the same size. And so the probability of finding states by picking a random point and minimizing is the same for all the states. The other thing which was interesting that we found, and perhaps was a little bit hidden in this work by all the entropy considerations, was that we identified some hierarchical structure in the energy landscape. what we found is that there is a strong power law between the pressure of the system, this is the stress, so in other words, the energy in the systems, and the volume of the basins. And what this power law is implying is that there is some hierarchy where small basins have high energy and large basins have low energy. And perhaps you could explain, you know, and it's scale-free in the way it's organized. Okay, so that brings me to the end of the first part, which had to do with computing traditional entropies, which were log omega and sum of PLOP, for non-traditional system, because this was a non-equilibrium system. Now I want to tell you about the other side, which is the information theoretic side of entropy. And, you know, even though Boltzmann and Gibbs introduced the macroscopic interpretation of entropy, it was Shannon that gave it meaning from the standpoint of an uncertainty function, you know, an amount of information. And you've probably all heard the story of how it came to be called entropy. Apparently Shannon was visiting Princeton and he was telling von Neumann about this. And von Neumann said at some point, why don't you call it entropy? Because Shannon wanted to call it information. It would have made a lot of sense. And the motivation that he gave was this. Von Neumann apparently told him, your uncertainty function has been used in statistical mechanics, so it already has a name. More importantly, nobody knows what entropy really is. So in a debate, you will always have the advantage. Okay, so how can we quantify information? So these are two pictures from Super Mario Bros. 86 that I made myself. As you can see, the image on the left has a lot less going on than the image on the right. So if I were to try and describe these two images, it would take me a lot less time to describe the one on the left than the one on the right. And so can we make the statement precise, right? I expect this to be more ordered than that one. And the answer is that we can use data compression to estimate how much more ordered the image on the left is than the image on the right, because the aim of data compression is to reduce the size of a file to its information content. And so the more organized or more ordered something is, the shorter should the length of its encoding be, right? So if I take these two images and I click save them as PNG of my computer, I find that the one on the left is 0.27 bits per pixel and the one on the right is 2.34 bits per pixel. And so clearly this complies with our intuition that the system on the left is more ordered than the system on the right. But can we use such an idea to understand the physics of many body systems? And to see that, I'm going to discuss a simple self-organizing model, which is called the conserved lattice gas. It's a one-dimensional model, which I call the subway model because I live in New York and it works just like the subway. There is a hard constraint in this model. So imagine this is a discrete grid where there are particles that occupy a site. And there is a hard constraint, which is no doubly occupied sites. Okay, you don't want to sit on top of other people in the subway. That's uncalled for. The other thing is that there is a soft constraint. There is no nearest neighbors. This is what's called a facilitated model. What it means is that you don't want to sit next to anyone else. So if someone comes next to you, you move, because everyone is rude in New York, so they don't care. And the dynamics is that if a neighboring site is occupied, you move, and the order parameter for this model is the fraction of active sites. It's how many of the occupied sites are active. And so if I start from this configuration, which I call an active configuration, I can displace my particles, okay, according to my dynamics by randomly picking a site and deciding whether to move a particle.
What does active mean again?
Active mean that you have a neighbor, that you have someone right next to you. Okay. So it's unpleasant to have people sitting next to you in the subway. And so you can keep going until you end up in what's called an absorbing configuration. So this class of models are called absorbing state models. You end up in an absorbing configuration where you only have where you never see a one surrounded by zero. So one is an occupied site, zero is an unoccupied site. So an absorbing state never has a one with another one next to it, okay? So if we look at at how the fraction of active sites changes with the density of ones on my grid, you will find that all the way up to 50%, you can always find an absorbing state dynamically. That is not obvious, it's very special of this model, because 50% here is the geometric limit, because you can have 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. You know that if you are above 50%, someone is going to have a neighbor. But in most models of this class, the geometric limit is much higher than the critical point. Because essentially what happens is that dynamically, you can never find a state that satisfies the constraints in the problem. But this one is special in that the geometric point and the critical point are the same. And so then at the critical point, you have now an increase with some power law in the number of active sites. And so if we want to understand this model from the point of view of its entropy, what we can do is that we can take our sequence of ones and zeros at different times, and we can compress it and measure the length of the compressed file relative to the original length of the sequence. So now when I start, I have a random sequence of ones and zeros. This is a simple Bernoulli sequence, and so I know what its entropy is. And if I evolve it over time, you see that the system starts ordering and that it develops a cusp at 50% because it's a perfectly ordered state. Now, it may not be visible, but if you look carefully, this feature on the right is higher than the one on the left, which we weren't expecting. We thought that this system should be symmetric in how it behaves, because I should be able to take an active configuration, replace all the ones with zeros and all the zeros with ones, and I should get an equivalent configuration on the other half, right? But that's not what happens. If I do that, so I compare what we call the CID, which is this compression entropy, between on the two sides, I find that in the active phase, the entropy of the states dynamically is the same as that of the states that I can generate by sampling them uniformly, okay? So basically, if I were to weight all the states with equal probability. But on the absorbing side, we find that the dynamics don't find the same states as if I sample uniformly, or in other words, the same states that the active phase finds. So John Lebowitz has done extensive work on this model, and they show that indeed, in the active phase, this is completely equilibrium, but it's non-equilibrium in the absorbing phase. And so to understand where this difference came from, what we did is that we looked at how the correlation length in the system grows as we approach this critical point. And you can see that if you sample states uniformly, you have a growth of the correlation length with a power of 1. But if you follow the dynamics, the correlation grows with a power of 2. So the system reaches states which are much more strongly correlated than the ones that you could generate by sampling uniformly. So it's basically selecting for strongly correlated states, and that is why it's more ordered. Now, what did I do when I was trying to compute this entropy? Well, we definitely did not just use an out-of-the-box compression algorithm. We went and we looked at how this algorithm worked, and we extracted the essence of it, which is the Lempel-Ziff's 77 factorization algorithm. And it's the unrestricted version of it, meaning that we don't have a window size. We got as back in the past as the sequence is long, right? And so the way it works is that you take a sequence, let's say ABC, AB, 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 and I want to compress it. So the way you can compress it is by decomposing it into these factors, which are essentially tuples. And these tuples are made of a position and a length. And so, because they're basically telling you that you have to go back to a certain position and copy for a certain length. That's how you compress. And so if you take the sequence, the first time that you encounter a symbol, you've never seen it before. And so what you would do here is that you would say, okay, well, I'm not gonna actually encode a position and a length. I'm gonna say just A zero because this is the first time I see it. And then I do a second time, B. First time I see it, B zero. Third one is C. Now I've never seen, so it's also C zero. But now we start seeing repetition. So now we can compress. So what we can do is that we can say, okay, go back to position zero and copy for length 2. And so I'll write 0, 2. And for the rest, all I have to do is say, go back to position 3 and copy iteratively as you reconstruct the sequence and do so for length 10. And that's indeed what we do. So now we've taken this sequence of length 14 and we've reduced it to 5 factors, each made of 2 numbers. And you can see that if you have a very long sequence, this is going to compress. And Lempel and Ziff proved that asymptotically this algorithm will converge to the entropy. So now the information, the entropy, is going to be less than the information required to specify these factors, right? And so what it's going to be, so to store the first number, which is the position, each number is going to be a most log n, and I have c of them. So it's going to be c log n, the amount of information to store this first number. to store the second number, it's going to be the, you know, n times the average of the logarithm of the length of the match. Now, this works pretty well, and we've used this in one-dimensional and two-dimensional systems by flattening our configurations, but it's obviously limited because for two reasons. One is that it's intrinsically one-dimensional, right? And so it's going to dilute correlations by raster scanning an image. And the second one is that the lamp-positive algorithm actually produces a code, right? This sequence here is a code, and I don't care about the code. I just want the entropy. So can we, you know, lose the code and just get something to give me an entropy? And indeed, I can do this with very simple mathematics. So I can take my Lamposive bound, and I can do something very simple. I can say that the sum of the log of the length of the matches is just the number of factors times the average log length. That's trivial. Then I can use the convexity of the log to rewrite the C average log L as C log L average. Okay. And then, if I using the fact that the number of factors is equal to the length of the sequence divided by the average length of the matches, I get that the entropy now is bounded by log n over average L plus log average L over L. But average L has to be order log n, because this quantity has to be about one, order one. And so this term is subdominant. I can get rid of it. And what this gives me is what we call a pattern matching estimator, which gives me a bound on the entropy only on the basis of the average match length between a sequence and some dictionary. This generalizes very well to two dimensions and beyond. And so the way it works is that you take two configurations coming from the same source. This could be two equilibrium configurations of an Ising model. And what we do is that we have a target configuration and a reference, which are equally distributed. They come from the same source. And we pick random points in the target configuration, and we look for a match in the reference. We pick another random point in target configuration, look for a match in the reference, and again. And this gives us an average size of the matches. And so now if you compute the entropy this way, you find that it agrees very well with the direct measurement for a two-dimensionalizing model, while if you use Lamposive-77 and scan, you have a significant deviation from the true answer. And that is because we're focused on the, now we can actually capture the two-dimensional correlations. Now, the holy grail in this field is to be able to do this on continuum systems, because you could take an experiment done with colloids, take a picture of it, and you could, you know, estimate the entropy of it from a couple of images, say. And so the way you do this for configurations is that now you have a density field, which is given by delta function. Each particle has a delta function, you know, at the position of the particle. And what we want to do now is that we want to window this density, and we want to look at the whether there is a match for this window of density into the reference. Now, if you want to look for matches in continuum, we have, you know, you can use the convolution theorem that tells you that a convolution in real space is a multiplication in Fourier space. So what we do is that we take our density, we Fourier transform them, okay? And then we multiply them together. Now we have a convolution. And when you inverse Fourier transform them, you get the correlation function and you can find the maximum. And so if you do this, you find some match, but we forgot rotations. So it's not gonna be optimal. So if you want to do this with rotations, you can basically use the same idea. You start from these two densities, you convert them to a translational invariant representation by taking the Fourier transform. Then you convert to log polar coordinates, where now rotations are translations and scalings are also translations. And again, you look for correlations between these log polar transformed Fourier transforms. And what you see here is basically a correlation function where this is the scaling and this is the angle. And of course, because these examples are order structures, you can always stretch an hexagonal lattice by a multiple of the lattice constant, and you will find some kind of match, right? But we only care about the alpha equal one, which is where, you know, the scale remains the same. And so you can then look at just the dependence with respect to the angle, and you see then you have one angle for which the match is optimal. And you have six because this, here you have roughly six-fold symmetry. And so now we first rotate, then we overlap. And if you do this to find the matches, you get the following. So if you were to use a real space approach to finding matches, you will get this red curve, okay? And if you were to discretize your configuration and use compression, it would be even worse than this. It would be like somewhere up here. But if you use this approach, we find that we can actually follow the entropy of the hard disk fluid. This dash curve was obtained using thermodynamic integration. You can find that there is a very nice agreement between the two. And then this is all preliminary. We still have issues at the smallest densities because we need to do Fourier transforms with like really high resolutions. And so our computers aren't big enough. Okay, so now let me conclude with the last thing, which is about applying these ideas to estimating irreversibility and entropy productions in systems out of equilibrium. And the reason why we care about this is because we want to quantify how far from equilibrium a system is. So what defines an equilibrium systems? Well, there are many definitions, but if you pick the one from Kirkwood and Oppenheim, you'll find that they say that the intensive property of the systems are independent of time, so you're in some steady state. And there is no current of matter or energy within the system or its boundary, so no fluxes, okay? Now, the reason why we define an equilibrium by defining equilibrium is that there is one way of being in equilibrium and infinitely many of being out of equilibrium. But is there a quantity that tells us how far from equilibrium we are? And the answer is yes. And it's the so-called entropy production. So entropy production is a measure of time reversal symmetry breaking in the system. So if you take this video by Edward Muybridge of a horse running forward and backwards, you can clearly tell them apart, okay? Because the motion is irreversible. Now, formally, the relationship between the probability of observing a forward trajectory and its reverse is given by fluctuation theorem that says that the ratio of the probability is equal to the exponential of the entropy production, okay? So what this is saying essentially is that if you watch a forward trajectory, if you now reverse it, is the reverse typical, right? Because the forward is definitely typical, but is the reverse typical? And if it's not typical, this quantity is gonna be greater than one. So entropy production quantifies the departure from equilibrium, the degree of time reversal symmetry breaking, and the thermodynamic cost of maintaining the systems of equilibrium. How do we measure it? Well, we use the same type of approaches that I described before. You observe your system evolving forward in time, you reverse the sequence, and now the way you estimate the entropy production is by measuring the KL divergence between the forward and the reverse trajectory. And so the KL divergence is nothing else but the difference between the cross entropy between the forward and the reverse and the entropy of the forward. So now remember this because it's important. And just to show you that this is the same thing as the entropy production, the KL divergence by definition, the expectation of the log with the ratio of the probabilities. So now we use again our pattern matching approach, and this is a symmetric estimator, okay, that we introduced for measuring these quantities. What we do is that we take a very long sequence in time, we split it in half, and we measure the entropy of the first half relative to the second half. So we pick a point in the second half, look for a match in the first half, do it many times, and our estimator will give us an entropy. Then we flip the first half, and we look for a match between the second half and the first half, again, do it many times, and this gives us the cross entropy. The difference between these two is the KL divergence. How does this estimator do? It does way better than all other cross-parsing methods that were introduced before. You can see for a three-state Markov models, we basically converge in about 10,000 long sequences. While previous approaches by Ziv and Marav, they were nowhere near. Roldan and Parrondo do a little bit better, but we are at least 1,000 times better.
Question. Is equilibrium, your definition of equilibrium implies time?
Time reversal symmetry.
Is that like the common definition in physics?
Yes. Okay. Things get tricky if there is magnetism involved.
If what?
If there is magnetism involved. Because if with magnetism, you can have currents in equilibrium. But generally speaking, if you don't have time reversal symmetry breaking, you're definitely in equilibrium.
Okay.
Okay, so why did I care about this? Well, because I saw this experiment. And so this is a set of colloids, which are basically TPM particles with a little piece of hematite, okay, that is a catalyst. And what it does is that if you put this particle in a bath of hydrogen peroxide and you turn the light on, they start swimming because the hematite decomposes the hydrogen peroxide, produces gas, and it propels the particles forward. And this is what happens. When you turn the light on, the particles come together. There is no cohesive interaction between these particles. They're coming together just because of the activity, okay? This phenomenon is called motility-induced phase separation and it's been a great object of study in non-equilibrium statistical physics for the last 10 years, okay? And what you see is that if I, let me see if I can skip forward. Okay, if I turn the light off, everything comes apart. You see, now we turn the light off and everything came apart. So there is no intrinsic attractive interaction between these particles. This model, this phenomenon, which is this aggregation, this clustering, induced only by activity, has been described by the group of Cates and co-workers, where what they've done is that they've used active field theories. And the deal of these field theories is that you take a simple Kahn-Hilliard model of phase separation, so you write your continuity equation, you write down your flux as a gradient of a chemical potential. But what they do is that they say, to the chemical potential, I'm going to add the lowest order term that I cannot derive from a free energy functional, which is basically what's going to give rise to irreversibility in my system. So if you look at the order parameter, this thing phase separates just like a regular equilibrium model. But if you look at the dissipation, you find that the system is dissipating at this ring, right? So it's dissipating at the surface of the cluster, while everywhere else, there's no dissipation. And so what's happening here, what they claim in this paper, is that at this coarse grain scale, the system is behaving like in equilibrium everywhere, except at the interface. And so at the time, I was discretizing everything because I was thinking about compression. So what I did is that I said, okay, why don't we discretize the system? And then we look at a given position of space, let's say a 2x2 block, and then track it over time and measure the KL divergence of the forward and reverse trajectory. This block is exaggerated. The real size is that you have one particle that fits the most inside the block. So you can be in one of five states, either each side is occupied or it's all unoccupied. And when you do this, this is what you find. That you have a large entropy reduction at the interface. You basically measure a lot of irreversibility in the dynamics at the interface of the cluster, which agrees with the field theory. The difference is that this is a model-free measurement that you can do on experiments or simulations without actually having to assume anything. And the reason why this is happening, why we have time reversal symmetry breaking event, is that imagine a self-propelled colloid coming to an interface. What it'll do is that it'll arrive, and then it will rotate slightly, and it will leave along the interface. If I reverse the trajectory, what that would amount to is that a particle will come down the interface and then spontaneously decide to turn around and leave. And that just doesn't happen because of how these particles move. What would happen is that the particle would just follow the interface. And so there is this asymmetry that breaks time reversal. You can do this by tracking more and more particles by extending your blocks. And so now you start picking up other features of time reversal symmetry breaking, which have to do with collisions between multiple particles. So these are different modalities. The reason why this is interesting, besides the fact that tell you how the system is breaking time reversal symmetry, is that you can relate this quantity to the extractable work in the system. So what we did is that for a simple model of time random particle in a ring, we were able to show that if you were to couple your system weakly to work extraction mechanism, the extractive power, so the work that you would be able to do, will be directly related to the entropy production, meaning that if the entropy production is zero on average, then you cannot extract work from the system, okay? And the other thing that he highlights is that the degrees of freedoms that you couple to, so the ones that you track, matter. So if you have this bullet moving on this track and you track positions at two adjacent sides, okay, but you do not consider the orientation, so you take the absolute value of the orientation, it will be the same as coupling it to a turnstile, okay, that couples to it regardless of which way the bullet is moving. And so if you were to do work on this turnstile, when you go this way, you rotate it clockwise, the other way counterclockwise, and you undo the work that you just did. But if you couple at the orientation, now it's like having a turnstile, the it only rotates one way and not the other. And so now you do have entry production and you can extract work. And just to demonstrate that you can do this in other settings, we looked at rectification in active matter. There is this non-equilibrium phenomenon where particles spontaneously decide to go into one side of this chamber. And it just has to do with the fact that the asymmetry in the motion couples to the asymmetry in the geometry. And so now all of the particle comes to one side. And so we did this with E. coli and with simulations, and we were able to make the measurements directly from both. And with that, thank you for your patience. This is work, I barely did any of this, except my PhD work. That's not true, lots of the postdoc work, but all the good stuff was done by, you know, my students, postdocs and collaborators. And this is my group in Minnesota before moving to New York in a balmy minus 30 day. And thank you.
I have a question about the first part of the talk, the packing one. So I kind of understand the theory, but what, so if you can find a minimum, you know, some kind of notion of minimum in a 1,000-dimensional space, what kinds of real problems can you solve with that?
If you can find the minimum?
I mean, you were looking for finding, sort of asking questions about packing in 1,000-dimensional spaces or mm-hmm. you know, n-dimensional spaces. So what's a practical application, if any?
Of understanding high-dimensional energy landscapes?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll give you a neural network example that you'll definitely be responsive to. So one of the things that I'm interested in right now, and I have a postdoc study on Monday to work on this, is that if you're able to measure the size of a basin, and the basin doesn't necessarily have to be a minimum in energy, it can be a collection of minima, so it's up to your definitions. You can, for instance, try to understand how the optimization dynamics determine the size of the basins, okay? So now let's say that I have a solution that is a generalizable solution to my training algorithm, and I have non-generalizable solution. By doing this, I can compute the relative probability of the two depending on the details of the dynamics, right? And so if I can show that there is a scaling relationship between generalization capacity and probability of finding states, then I can show that that these systems are, well, not provably, but they are at least empirically known to always find the best possible solutions, right? So there is a generic question in the theory of deep learning, which is why do they always learn? And if you can show that as you make the system bigger, the generalizable solution become overwhelmingly larger, then you've shown that you're basically guaranteed to learn every time. So that would be a real world application of this. There are it's mostly useful in optimization because you can basically try to understand what is the probability of finding a given solution in non-convex optimization. Yeah.
So in relation to the last bit of the talk, like I saw a talk of Mike Cates like a year and a half ago or something, and the entire talk was about how essentially the notion of reversibility isn't always so clear. In your case, it seems to be literally just like playing the film backwards, but this something that you had to like play around with, because you can like change.
It's not clear because it's coarse graining.
Mm-hmm.
So when you coarse grain, then you can lose reversibility,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's a question of the scale.
Yes.
If you coarse grain your system, something that is reversible will become reversible at a larger, say, length scale or time scale, right? Mm-hmm. And so in that sense, it's not uniquely defined. It depends on the details and it depends on which degrees of freedom you're looking at.
Okay.
Right.
Whether a system is in equilibrium or not depends on the coarse graining.
Yes. Well, okay. The system has a complete set of degrees of freedom defining it, right? So it will be either in equilibrium or not in equilibrium in real life. But whether it behaves as if you were in equilibrium from your perspective, which is, okay, let's say I only care about the positions of the particle, I don't care about the internal states of the system, then it could behave as an equilibrium system and you can treat it as such, right? So let's say you could take bacteria, they have internal metabolism, they're definitely non-equilibrium, but now they start behaving as if they were in equilibrium. If all I care about is how they move, then it's an equilibrium system at that scale, even though, you know, obviously they're non-equilibrium, right?
So, I mean, reversibility in that sense is more of a kind of idealistic idea for all realistic.
It's reversibility in the degrees of freedom mm-hmm. that you're considering.
Yes.
So the observer is in the picture, mm-hmm. in this sense. Yeah. I knocked you out.
All right, that's...